Okay, thank you very much for having me. It's a great pleasure for me to be here at Force 11 because I think it's a great crowd and also a good crowd to discuss the topics that I think about a lot in my research. So I work at the Humboldt Institute for Internet and Society in Berlin. My name is Benedikt, and I have been doing a lot of research with my team in the last 5 years, actually, on open science. And today I'm trying to bring a couple of these thoughts together. I want to talk about infrastructure for scholarly publishing, and more precisely about the governance for open access infrastructure. And I will try to do so by giving a quick historical overview, and then relating also to current initiatives. And what I'm presenting are more or less, I'd say, thoughts in progress. And I believe this is the perfect crowd to discuss these matters with. And I will end with a few questions in the end, and that I hope will also spark a discussion. So first off, what do I mean when I say infrastructure or research infrastructure, and what makes an infrastructure? Let me just try to define that real quick, or approach that real quick, because I think this is one of these terms that everyone uses and everyone has a different idea about. So I'd like to introduce two rules for, there are a couple of approaches, there are also these 8 rules that are famous, but I'd like to stick to 2 rules that I think could constitute a universal definition of research infrastructure. And one of them is that we only think about it once it doesn't work. So this is a picture of a train station in Berlin. I took it 2 weeks ago when I was going to a conference in Göttingen, the Soziologie Congress, or sociology conference. And what it basically says is that the train is running late. It's kind of funny also because when visitors come to Germany, they always say that the trains in Germany are always on time. And when Germans think about the trains in Germany, they say they are always late. And of course, the truth is a bit in between. Trains in Germany are late, but mostly they are on time. The only country where trains are always on time is, of course, Switzerland. In Switzerland, the trains are always on time. So what I'm trying to say is that not many people think much about infrastructure and only think about it or become aware about it once it doesn't work. And this is a second picture that I want to show, because I'm sure that many of you have similar images in mind when they think about train stations or airports, because they are also places of arrival and places of departures. They are places of memories where we kiss and where we depart and where we split. And they are, of course, also the shitty food courts and the platforms from where we leave, and conference and family gatherings. So what I'm trying to say here is that they're also deeply intertwined with practice, that are deeply intertwined with our everyday life. And it is something emotional and sometimes almost romantic. And as you can see or tell from these first 2 rules that I introduced, is that I do not necessarily see infrastructure as something solely technical, and also not something solely social. I think it's something socio-technical. And I think this also relates a lot to infrastructure for scholarly communication, because we only think about it when it doesn't work, and it is deeply intertwined with our everyday practice. And open access, I think, is a perfect showcase for our weird negligence of research infrastructure, and also our weird emotional attachment to it. And the question is here also, for whom does it work and for whom does it not work? And how does that reflect into the way research infrastructure is laid out? So, I don't want to go too deep into that, because I think most of the people here probably know everything about the history of scholarly communication, but I'm just saying a few words because I think there are some neuralgic points that I think are important. So the picture that you see here is a picture of the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society of London, which is arguably the first journal in the from the 17th century. So in my view, and I think many of you would agree, the article-based communication system is still the main infrastructure for scholarly communication. And journals are the resources that are used by the scientific community to disseminate knowledge and from one to another, and it's also how we relate to each other. If you want to have an academic career, of course, you need to publish an article because, or a peer-reviewed article, because it is where the results are documented, not blogs or YouTube, or at least not yet. And peer-reviewed articles in top journals are still often the proxy for excellence. So despite the fact that much has changed since the first scientific journal, for example, the peer review is something that is probably something post-war rather, and only few would argue with the fact that it's still the core infrastructure for scholarly communication. journals and articles are deeply intertwined with our daily practice, at least in research. And I'm sure this is not, as I said, the kind of crowd that I need to tell the whole story about, but I still want to go into a few points that I think are of particular relevance. And let's start with the second half of the 20th century, when most of the journals were still actually published by libraries or scholarly societies. And this is a graph that I took from an article from La Riviere and Haustein, who I think are also going to talk today. And it's from an article from PLOS One in 2015 called The Oligopoly of Academic Publishing, which pretty much summarizes also their main result. I have a couple of these graphs, and they all basically say the same. So what you can see here is some kind of concentration that started from the 70s and went onwards to modern day, and more. And that it only shows the articles that are published by the top five publishers. So this is for the fields that say rather close to social sciences and humanities, but the same is also true if you look at the natural sciences or the hard sciences, that is often called. And you can also see, if you look at this graph, that most of the moves or most of those concentrations moved from small publishers to big publishers. So I hope you can see the colors, but it's actually, you could also only look at the orange one from big publishers to small publishers, and you can see that this is basically irrelevant in the last few years. So what are the reasons for that? And I think it has a lot to do with the increasing investments in research at that time and the approaches towards new public management, and that also became prominent since the 60s, and which led to the need for KPIs, of course, and most prominent, of course, the journal impact factor that was introduced by Garfield. So in the period that followed, a division of labor came into being. Academia does research and publishers do publishing, and core journals emerged that now belong to commercial publishers, which of course was still was totally fair at that time and often sometimes still is. But what we have to realize here, what we have to point out, is that academia basically lost or outsourced its core infrastructure, and increasing relied on a few publishers also meant that these were, of course, relatively free when it comes to pricing policies. So this leads me back again to one of the rules that I introduced, is that it's only at infrastructure, we only realize that infrastructure exists when we see that it doesn't work. And the people for whom this worked less, were of course libraries, and libraries had to buy package deals for subscription fees in order to serve their researchers. And subscription fees were going up and took large percentages of the library budgets. So some of the coolest people that I know are librarians, and are also very good friends of mine, but with all due respect, many of them are not usually the people that would instigate a revolution. But in this case, they did, and it says a lot about the severeness of the situation at that time. And on the other hand, and this is a claim that I'm going to make that many of you would not, perhaps not confirm, but it is my impression that at least for researchers, actually, it most of the time does work, at least in the Western countries. The article-based communication system works perfectly for them. Actually, I believe most researchers actually only realized how much publishing cost when Gold Open Access came into being. So I would go so far to say that usually researchers don't care and don't know the specifics of research infrastructure, and for them recognition is vital. So this is also why the main argument actually to convince researchers to publish open access is most of the time the citation advantage, which of course would also disappear if every article was open access. So in many respects, I'd say that open science in general and open access in particular is a bit like the electric car that most people would agree is good for the environment, but only few would actually drive. And much of this has to do, of course, with convenience. So for example, with the car, where can I charge my car? And also with the costs. So batteries, for example, for electric cars are very expensive at the moment. So most people don't particularly like change, I would say, and most people would not particularly like jump on the change train so quickly. And this holds true also, of course, for open access and open access infrastructure. The claim, and I think someone said that earlier, if you build it, they will come, is of course bullshit in many respects. And this, of course, also allows, or this negligence like of research infrastructure allows, of course, also publishers like Elsevier and many others to kind of hijack the term open access and calling themselves the largest open access advocates, which, of course, is a form of appropriation. My friend John Tennant said that having Elsevier advocating for open access would be like having McDonald's advocating dietary nutrition or something. And this is kind of true. But just to be clear, I would never, I do not blame Elsevier and I do not blame other publishers. I think they are actually acting smart in that sense. I think who we have to blame much more are many key players in the scientific community and for their organized stupidity. And this leads me to the third rule that I want to lay out. So the third rule is once it's laid out, it's difficult to change. So this is also relating to infrastructure. The OA movement or the open access movement started somewhat as an infrastructure movement, claiming that the internet changed the practical and economic realities of distributing scientific knowledge, which is of course true. You could simply put your articles on a repository under a CC license at minimum server costs, and others could read and distribute it. You could build overlay journals on top of it, mimicking basically a normal journal, and you could build those platforms and infrastructures openly so others could use the API. And of course, you have funders initiatives that we cannot really anticipate now, their impact, like those from the Wellcome Trust or the European Commission. That I think actually could learn a lot from initiatives like Silo, for example, that's happening in Latin America right now. But with the internet, I think there's still a brief moment in time that the infrastructure for scholarly publishing could change. But if you look at the current political endeavors in many, at least European countries, we are actually running rather into danger of reproducing the same dependencies from commercial publishers. So. This is actually a screenshot from a blog that a few colleagues in my run, you should have a look into it and also contribute if you want to. It's called Elephant in the Lab. So this is one commercial part here. But here we had an interview with Nick Fowler and Gerard Meyer, who were also kind of the head negotiators of DEAL in a way. So Gerard Meyer in the Netherlands and Nick Fowler is from Elsevier. And so in Europe, for example, you have these offsetting agreements at the moment. These are very en vogue, in which coalitions of research institutions negotiate big deals with publishers. Austria is doing that, Finland is doing that, Switzerland is doing that, you name it, Sweden is doing that too, and Germany, of course, is also doing that. And in Germany, the so-called deal negotiations are more than 200 research institutions right now negotiating with the main publishers to come to an agreement, a so-called read and publish agreement. So you would be, as a German researcher, free to publish, and you would be free to read any publication that appeared there. And I think it's an honorable approach, but it treats open access solely as a licensing issue. And not what it is, in my opinion, first and foremost, an infrastructure issue. In my view, this like initiatives like DEAL could, for example, lead to a reproduction of the same dependence from a few commercial publishers in the digital age. And it would also not probably lead like, to a better situation for researchers, for example, in the global south or those who are not in the rich west who could actually afford those deals to buy in. So, and it's also, ironically, libraries and librarians who are in the forefront of these negotiations, and somehow you can also wonder if they are actually sawing the branch on which they sit. Yeah. So when it comes to the governance of research infrastructure for scholarly publishing, I see actually two core players that are perhaps not acting in their best interest at the moment, and those are infrastructure providers such as libraries, which need to rediscover their role as knowledge brokers and also as an infrastructure for knowledge creation and dissemination, and policymakers who need to understand that research infrastructure is key for a blooming research landscape. These two need to work together in order to make it as comfortable as possible for researchers to switch sometimes, and they need to specifically target, in my eyes, upcoming fields that do not yet have core journals. And I also say this because I think the history of scholarly publishing teaches us that we need to be careful that we do not run into the same dependencies when it comes to emerging products for scholarly communication. And this is, of course, not only true for articles. I mean, we publish too many articles anyway, so we need to put focus also on different or alternative scientific outputs. And the question is, like, what will be the infrastructure for these? And for these parts of formats or aspects of scholarly communication, and this includes, of course, data, software, metadata, and metrics. So to finish my quick talk is also with three questions that I think are interesting or relevant, and I think could be discussed here, which is also relating to what I said before. So what are performance indicators that support good practice and prevent intellectual lock-ins? How can we build innovative public or non-commercial infrastructure? So what would be good business models to do that? And and what would be sustainable business models for tools and services that support the scholarly community first? And also another commercial break, and this after that I will finish my presentation. We are having a conference in November and or in December on blockchain for science, and those who want to see if the hype is true or not can come there, and who wants to participate can go to me, because then I can give you a discount. So that's it. Thank you very much.
For those who haven't seen the tweet, we're going on until 2:10, so the schedule's shifted by 10 minutes. So, any questions?
Thank you. Thanks for a very interesting presentation. There's a lot I agree with, but there's one point that you make which I'd like if you could elaborate. You say that for the most part, the academic infrastructure is working for researchers. I find this a very problematic statement. So I wonder if you could unpack why you think you make that case.
Well, this is a rather broad assumption that I make, and I wouldn't say that this is completely the case, but I think for many researchers that I know and colleagues that I have, nothing is really wrong, because they are just in their daily monkey business and don't care so much. We had a study a couple of years ago where we looked at data practices, and we did a survey on how people collect data and where they put it and what kind of recognition they want for it. And one of the results, and this is of course also common knowledge why they wouldn't share, is because they don't get credit for it, and they want to use it in order to publish articles from it. And so what I'm saying, what I'm getting from that is let's say the incentive structure that many stick to are not really connected with, say, sustainable infrastructure decisions, because it's not close to their practice. And in an ideal world, those incentives would also be gone to products and practices that are good for scholarly communication on a large scale. I'm not sure if that makes sense in total, but I wouldn't say this is a complete truth that I said there. All right.
Else?
Oh, yeah.
Thanks. Just to go back. Hi. Thank you. By the way, it was an interesting presentation. I'm Kathleen Shearer from CORE, and to go back to your questions, maybe you could just put them up again.
Yeah.
So I think just to respond to some of the things that you said in your presentation about libraries cutting off the branch that they're sitting on, what I think is libraries should be creating and hosting and managing infrastructure for scholarly communication. And that's where they should be moving their subscription money towards. As you know, that's the vision of the next generation repositories. But one of the big challenges for libraries is how they can rationalize that with their administrators, and how we can move from the major operations of libraries going into supporting subscriptions towards open infrastructures. And so I wonder if you had any thoughts about that.
I have to say, I have a few, but I think there are many in this room who could give much better answers to this question. But I think it's also about identifying best practices and seeing where it already works and why it works, and then trying to learn from them. So I couldn't give a good answer to that question, to be honest. No.
You said at one point, I mean, there are many things said, but there was just one thing you mentioned about how if all journals became open access, then citation rates would plummet. And you sort of mentioned that briefly, but as though it was sort of an obvious outcome of that, and I'm just curious why you said that.
Maybe that was, a side note. I'm not sure if that would be really the case, but I could imagine if every article...
Can you repeat the question, please?
Oh, he asked, because I said that if every article was open access, the citation advantage wouldn't be present anymore. And I'm not sure if this would be the case. This was just a thesis, but I think the citation advantage has also something to do that a few articles now are better visible and available than the others. And this is why they perhaps also get cited more. This is just a thesis, and I think if every article was available, then this would not be the case anymore, because this competitive advantage of a single output would not be present for the others. I'm not sure if that makes sense, but we can also discuss that afterwards if you want.
So you kept coming back to this question of whether, if we don't think infrastructurally, we just replicate the status quo. And then you also said, or implied, I think what you're heading was infrastructure doesn't really get created, it evolves. It's difficult to shift. Apply that notion of infrastructure thinking across to the funding. Can we really talk about doing things differently unless we also change the infrastructure of our funding arrangements? Mm. Because that then gets back to your question of what the business models that are not accessible at the moment because the time for the financing doesn't exist.
Yeah, this is a great question, because I've been involved in the infrastructure project as well, and I think it's working similarly. So you have, for example, an idea in 2013, then you get the funding in 2014, and then you spend the next 5 years working on work packages that you had 6 years ago. And this has, for example, nothing to do with agile development. So I think the organizing principle of how we do research infrastructure, at least in often publicly funded projects, doesn't really correspond to the way how software development today now works. At least this is my impression. And then also often, for example, in these let's say publicly funded research infrastructure projects, the rollout is not part of the funding. So you build something, you build a prototype or a beta version, and then you don't have to really check if it's resonating with the community. I think this is an issue as well. So a lot of the problems that come with publicly funded research infrastructure projects, I think, have to do with the way how they are organized and how the funding stops with the beta product that has not really been tested in the community. This is also just an assumption. Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.